Thank you very much, Bob, and welcome to Rosemont, Illinois. I'm right next to Chicago, my hometown. And I'm pleased to be coming to this conference. First time I've been to an OMTEC conference, very impressive. So a little bit about me and why I'm here. I'm actually a fellowship-trained adult reconstructive orthopedic surgeon. What that means is basically I do hip and knee replacements for a living. And did my residency in orthopedics in the mid-80s, and a fellowship back here in Chicago at Rush University Medical Center under the tutelage of George Galante, who was one of the pioneers in cementless fixation. And I would agree with Bob that porous materials have really transformed the way we do surgery, and that was certainly a success story. I also run the research program at Rush University Medical Center. I'm the vice president for research. And so a little bit unlike the other two panelists, which are entrepreneurial, I'm more focused in the research area. So I tend to be the skeptic and show me the evidence person, as opposed to let's just jump in and try something new. And that's based on a career doing research, which I would say has to do with failure analysis. Looking at things that have gone bad, some of the things that Bob mentioned in his talk, modular implants, bad bearing surfaces, trying to understand why they went bad to make them better and to solve some of the problems we see in the clinic. And so I have done a lot of research funded by NIH looking at the failure mechanisms in total joint replacements, focusing on the biology of joint replacements, the biology of orthopedic implants, and that's something that we'll talk more about. And I've had some leadership roles in orthopedics, being president of the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons in 2013, and before that in 2006 or 7, being president of the Orthopedic Research Society. So my current research focuses on tribal corrosion performance of contemporary hip replacements. I'm not quite as optimistic as Bob that we have the 30-year hip yet, but I think we might be close and we might be getting there, and we'll talk a little bit about that. I tend to be the funnel for every unhappy patient with their joint. Seems to find their way to Chicago to see me because of the concern about metal allergy. This again goes into some of the biological impacts of what we do. And I come to this with a background not only in medicine, having gone to medical school and an orthopedic residency, but studying a material science as an undergraduate. And always during my training, spending time in research laboratories, for example, the biomaterials laboratory at Northwestern, when I was an undergraduate, and then in medical school in the laboratories of George Galante, and as a resident in the corrosion laboratory at MIT. So I've always tried to use my background in material science and engineering to really understand what we're seeing in the clinic and how that what we're seeing clinically relates to the performance of the materials that we're using. And I think that's been a very effective background for me to contribute to the orthopedic literature. So what has worked? Well, clearly what we do clinically, and that's Doug and I. Doug and I are adult reconstructive orthopedic surgeons. Total hip and total knee replacements are probably the most successful operation known to man. Certainly, it's the biggest advance in the treatment of arthritis and other end-stage degenerative disease in the last century. And some have termed this the operation of the century. And those pictures showing pole vaulters and high jumpers is to say because of the success of this operation, which currently survivorships at 10 years of in the mid to high 90% range, and at 15 years we're approaching that, there's a very high bar to make this operation better. Now it's not perfect, but it's a very high bar. And unlike the time when Bob and I started to get into this business, you can see from my gray hair, I've been doing this for a while. I've been in over 30 years. Things have changed. Some of the problems we were dealing with and the high failure rates that we saw with the first generation of cementless implants, the first few generations of polyethylene bearing materials, those have been solved. So it's a very high bar now for new technology to make an impact in this field. And I think this is a theme that will come up through our discussion section. So the historical challenges we had in joint replacement when I got into this area in the mid-80s, aseptic loosening. We have much better materials now to promote long-term biologic fixation, bone ingrowth. And we understand that biology much better than we did. We have better materials. So that's, for all practical purposes, been solved if the implant is put in correctly. because of the advances in our understanding of tribology, particularly the advancements in cross-linked polyethylene that Dr. Poggi mentioned, where, although not solved, is really we have it tamed. And I think we do have a 15, 20-year hip. Whether we have a 30 or 40-year hip remains to be seen, and there's probably new technologies that can be brought to bear to get to that point. And because we've solved this problem of wear largely, the problem of osteolysis or periprosthetic bone loss, that is inflammatory bone loss around an implant due to the debris from the wear process, that's also been solved. So that's worked. But there are things that have not been solved, and there are current problems in arthroplasty. First and foremost, in my area, what I study is this concept of tribal corrosion. And I think we really understand tribology fairly well in orthopedics. What we understand a little less well, and we're starting to get attuned to it, is this interaction between not only the mechanical, the tribological processes, but also the electrochemical, the corrosion processes. And that has been an Achilles heel of ours with some of the modular implants that we introduced recently, the neck modularity and other types of modularity, but also in the typical head-neck modularity that is now the standard of care in hip replacements. There are problems there, and we need to understand those, and those are that is currently one of the main failure mechanisms of primary total joint replacements in the U.S. We still haven't completely solved the problem of instability, that is dislocation after total hips, or perhaps instability in total knees. The infection, we've done really nothing with it in decades. After the introduction of antibiotics and special flow and maybe changing our operating rooms to make them ultra-sterile, we haven't changed the infection rate to somewhere around 1%. And so that's where we do need innovation and we need improvements. And then, of course, as good as our implants are, I don't think we are restoring the normal function. I don't feel comfortable letting my patients do whatever they did that led up to the problem of getting end-stage arthritis. I don't think we're there yet, and particularly in total knee arthroplasty. And finally, we haven't solved the problem, and I think one of our biggest problems is variations in surgical technique that can lead to failures, and that's where some of the new technologies that are coming through that you hear from other speakers may have a role. So what are our opportunities to improve the future? To utilize the revolution in biotechnology to develop biochemical, biomechanical biomarkers to make appropriate implant choices and or targeted biological treatments. One of the ways that we attack the problems in joint arthroplasty is we make better implants. Another way is to understand the biology of implant failure and to manipulate the biology of the patient that gets the implants. And that's an up-and-coming field, and that's, I think, a very promising future looking at the biology, taking advantage of the revolution of biotechnology, as I said, and the use of big data. Increased durability of total joint replacement device with advanced testing protocols, and this refers to better and better mimicking or simulating the in vivo environment so that preclinical testing can be more predictive of failures. Because I would argue that the major failures we've seen in orthopedics have not been predicted. The failure of metal-metal, the failure of modular implants, they were not adequately predicted by the preclinical tests that were being done. Improve computer algorithms to better predict wear and performance in silico, better mathematical modeling techniques, taking advantage of advancements in computing technology, and also simulation of our reconstructions. Further understanding of tribal corrosion, what drives it, and I think just as we've improved the performance of polyethylene with good, hard, basic material science, I think we can do the same thing with metals if we understand the mechanistic aspects of tribal corrosion. And finally, new engineering tools and performance analysis, we'll probably talk more about that in the discussion section. So with that, I will introduce our next speaker, Kay Palestra, and thank you very much for your attention.